Good morning to all. We were discussing about the somatoclonal variations in the preceding lecture. Let's continue with them. In the identification of somatoclonal variants, what we have discussed till now is with in vitro selection and without in vitro selection. In without in vitro selection, obviously most of the times the callus gets resulted, and callus, from the callus you have to get the shoots. Those shoots needs to be rooted, and gradually they have to be transferred to the greenhouse. That process is known as the hardening process. After the plant has been hardened, it has to be transferred to the field in order to get the actual variations, whatever you are supposed to get. Now, this process is nothing but without in vitro selections, as we have not selected the variations or the abnormal plant or an artifact in vitro. Now, this, if you look into the very process, it is though easy, but the major limitation is it is a chance factor, because nothing is in your control. The very basis of somatoclonal variations, it's all the play of, you may refer to that as a god or the other factors, whatever it is not in your hands. So as it is a chance factor, in most of the times you might not be lucky in order to identify or to obtain the somatoclonal variations, but in few instances, yes, the people have reported somatoclonal variations, though it was a chance factor. Now, the second method with in vitro selections, here everything will be controlled by the operator like you or me. Now, what we do is literally we tamper with the medial component, maybe with the physical aspects during culturing or chemical basis, or we play in a different manner so as to obtain deliberately the somatoclonal variations. Now, with all these concoctions, varying factors, they actually result in oxidative stress, and that causes the somatoclonal variations. Now, if you do that, then it becomes with in vitro selections. Now, isolation of somaclones with in vitro selection method basically involve handling of plant cells in culture, which could be a callus or a protoplast or any resulting thing in tissue culture, maybe an embryo or a shoot or a root. Now, like microorganisms, even these cells could be handled, and now you can identify the variations because of their biochemical nature or any physical appearances. The cell lines are screened from plant cultures for their ability to survive in the presence of a toxic or inhibitory substance in the medium or under conditions of environmental stress. Now, let's consider an example. Aluminum is the most abundant element. Now, because of n number of factors, we are creating a stress into the plants. Now, one of that stress is aluminum toxicity. Now, when the aluminum concentration has been already increased, plant fails to give you the desired result. If that is the case, what I am going to do is that in the media, whatever media, aluminum is not normally not incorporated as a major or minor growth factor. Now, what if I am interested to produce a plant with the aluminum resistivity, I will incorporate aluminum salts in whatever form available and dilute accordingly in different aliquots, and I'll design a micropropagatory protocol wherein different aliquots are added into the growth media. Now, when the explant are inoculated in a media, the same aluminum becomes a toxic substance, and believe me, most of the times you may not get appropriate result in the form of a callus or an embryo or a shoot or root, whatever. Over 90 or 95% of the explants, they're going to die. But whatever remained after, you know, repeated subculture or the stipulated time, maybe even a fractions, one or two plants, that itself is a boon for you. Why? Because they have tolerated the toxic level of aluminum compared to their peers. Now, this becomes an advantage. Now, this might have shortened the breeding cycle, which otherwise might have taken even several years or several decades. Now, explant is subjected to different stress factor as quoted right now. Resistant plant is selected and subcultured further. Now, you can do another thing. When the plant has been exposed to the very low stress level, you can subculture them. During the subculture process, you can increase the concentration of the same aluminum. That actually, you know, hardens or makes the plant resistive against the same stress molecule. Now, it is after the variation has been stabilized. When you look about the vigor or the normal phenotype has been attained by the plant. Now, in the next process, in order to bring in the real somatoclonal variations, what you are supposed to do? When it has been hardened, you have to make sure that they are selfed. Selfing is nothing but you have to use the pollen grain from the same plant and you have to generate the new set of plant. So selfing actually, it brings in the homozygosity, and because of the homozygosity, the true breeding lands can be produced. Now, before you release such somatoclonal variations into the field, maybe in a form of a commercial seed, you have to make sure that whatever variations you have bought in with the in vitro selection process, that has to be firmly assured. You can do that with the molecular markers, RAPD, ISSR, SSR, ISS, whatever markers available. Then the morphological features, most of the times, though they are very common, they do have their own role in identifying. Then the advanced cytological techniques like the flow cytometry, wherein the laser beam is pointed towards the nucleus of a cell which pre-labeled with the fluorescence dyes. Now, because of their DNA change, maybe which gets reflected in terms of the ploidy, that can be inferred by the flow cytometry result in the form of a graph, or you can consider n number of isozymes. Obviously, when you look into the isozyme assays, you can easily identify the variations produced. Now, when you compare the in vitro selection with without in vitro selection, as the very process has been considered in a in vitro or small scale, the time required or time consumed is also very short. Now, what are the factors affecting the somatoclonal variations? It could be a genotype from one plant to the other, from within the same species. The genotype or the total genome is varying. Accordingly, the stress factor which may haunt a single plant might not be the same haunting factor for a other plant. Because of these, the genotype, the first it is the very important factor in order to get a variation. Then the duration of culture. As long as you are holding the cells in vitro, you are giving a scope for the DNA variations. Consider the callus. You may have the compact callus or a friable callus. When you subculture the same callus without being reflected in a shoot or a root, what happens? The callus becomes acquainted to the media and it starts playing its own genome. Now, during that process, the DNA might get altered, or whenever you see different callus cells, they all may have different ploidy, and this actually brings in the somatoclonal variation. So, older the culture, more chances of obtaining the somatoclonal variations. But the negative shade of this is that when the culture becomes very acquainted or very old, then it loses simultaneously the regeneration capacity. So yes, you can have the somatoclonal variations, but simultaneously the realistic to bring in the plants from such explants becomes difficult. So though it is the actual boon for the somatoclonal variations, but the same might not be getting reflected in terms of the plant propagation. In the next video, let's look into other aspects which do affect the somatoclonal variations. Thank you.